always something interesting to tell about the history of watercolor. I'm looking very forward and thank you, Lisette, for doing this.
Yes. Thank you for the invitation to talk about the watercolors. Watercolors is considered as the most difficult painting technique. So I saw the exposition before I came here in this room. And I appreciate it very, very much. So congratulations with this nice manifestation, with all the works from the people of other countries. I'm surprised to see all this, because it's the most difficult painting technique. That is more than oil painting, for instance. It has to be right at once. You cannot correct it. You cannot change it. So you must do it with a good concentration, and you cannot make it false. You cannot make a correction. It's a matter of a combination with pigment, water, and paint above all. And you have to try to get the light. Light is also very important, light and shadow. That is what we see. I will show you from the beginning of the watercolors till the beginning of the 20th century. We will see figurative art, but also abstract art. Watercolor in abstract art. Dus die transparent color layers, that is special for this watercolor technique. And we will see the different results, beautiful results, as well as I saw in this exposition, which is organized here. Next one. The watercolor is the oldest technique to express. It's an expression since human being. It starts with painting on the rocks, no paper that time. So that is the original watercolors, because it's the same method with the pigments and with the water. I think people who are going to galleries or museums and they see watercolors, they don't imagine that the start is there in the prehistoric times. But that is the origin, and that is very interesting. Because pigments, they are made from plants, from minerals, from stones, earth, etc. And it's a combination with water. This is what the people had at that time, that kind of pigments. You can combine it with gum, gum arabic, as a binding agent. And some people later on, they make experience with also eggs as well to combine. In the prehistoric times, we see the drawings on the rocks, which is used as well the same methods that time. The next one, we will see the same. This is in Sulawesi, also the rocks. That is interesting of the prehistoric watercolors, because you see them all over the world. It's a universal expression what we see. If you go to Australia, or if you go to France, Lascaux, or Altamira in Spain, or you go America, South America, North America, Canada, you will see this kind of prehistoric expressions with watercolor. The next one. But then, the paper. The paper is a very important thing. The paper and the pigments, the paint, and the water, that will be the start in Europe. China made the paper, first century after Christ. Paper is, they made paper in China. So that is why I show this. This is the 17th century, but the Chinese people, they start to make the first watercolors on paper. And it was brought to Europe. The paper, I think, in Italy is second century after Christ, and France as well. But the start is in China. That is why I see this, because I show you this, because in China they make a lot of drawings of watercolors. They make it the long scrolls, they make it in the length, horizontal, but also vertical, for special rituals as well, in relationship with Buddhism. So So that is very unique as well, to represent the watercolors in what they call scrolls. And so here's the Qing dynasty, 1644. And China was was important to develop the technique of watercolor, as we should see it. Also the pencils. I saw the demonstration before the opening, and you see also, you saw also the different kind of pencils, the thin one, the big one. That is also important. It is an interaction between people, the paper, the water, the pigments, and the pencil. That is what we see. In China, they used bamboo brush on rice paper. And this we call the scrolls, and they are mystical as well. And you see also the transparent, the light color in this resultaat. The next one. Yeah, also in Roman times, we see murals. Murals in Pompeii, they found in Pompeii and Herculaneum. And other cities in Italy, but we can also remember the paintings from the Renaissance art in 1300 from Giotto, for instance, or 15th century from Masaccio. We have to think about Leonardo da Vinci. These people, they make frescoes. We call these murals frescoes. But that is the same method, the same way of making watercolors, like we see in the prehistoric times. In China, on paper, prehistoric times on the rocks, and then as well on the murals in Italy. So here is an example. But also in the books of the Greek times, in the antiquity times, Italy, Greece, if we think about that, we have paper as well, second century after Christ. But that is pergament. It's made of the skin of the animals. And that is not so good for making watercolors. It must be paper. That is the best way. And not the skin of animals, of goats, for instance. That is not good. It's too heavy and it's too much oil as well on the skin. So that is why it doesn't take the pigments on a fluent way. The next one. Then in the Middle Ages. In the Middle Ages, everything was was surrounding the beliefs. The religion was very important. People was the religion was the main point in the Middle Ages. We talk about the 8th century, 9th century, the time of Charlemagne, but also 11th century, 12th century, the Roman, the Gothic times, etc. And that time, people used to make manuscripts. Manuscripts have illustrations, so sometimes they use to make watercolors as well. And so we see the watercolors is not new in 19th or 20th century, but it is always there since the humanity, since the beginning of human being. The next one. We see an example as well from one of the manuscripts. It's a manuscript about the plants. The plants, so that is very interesting. The next one, a big, great master, Dürer, Albrecht Dürer. If you see the watercolors of Albrecht Dürer, you cannot imagine a man is making this, because it's very, very fantastic. We call the period he's living in the Renaissance. The Renaissance is different from the Middle Ages, because in the Renaissance we see the human being as the main point, not the religion. It's the human being which is important. So the science is developing, etc. But also the technique of arts and crafts is developing. And Albrecht Dürer was a very, very big artist. He traveled a lot. He was born in south of Germany, in Nuremberg. And he went to Venice to visit Titian. Titian made big and beautiful, splendid murals in Venice. And he was going on. He also went to the Netherlands, because he also traveled to Belgium, Netherlands, etc. But He was very famous also about prints making. The books, since Dürer was there, the books developments is there as well. That is very important because of the books development, you can spread your ideas by books through the world, which is Renaissance idea. He has made the woodcut prints. He was in contact with the major Italian artists of his time, including Raphael, Giovanni Bellini, beautiful painter in Venice as well, and Leonardo da Vinci. His watercolors show naturalistic details and is worked out very subtle. The next one is also from him. You can see here the atmosphere. It's given in a very nice way because of the technique of watercolor. It should be very different in oil painting because Dürer also made beautiful oil paintings, but it's very different. The watercolors are bright, light, and transparent. So that is the special technique. The next one. Also Dürer, this watercolor shows the peaceful panoramic view of a curved river, a distant town as we see, and also the mountains in the background. Dürer highlights the tranquil atmosphere through this blending of pigments such as blue, green, white and pink. It's dating 1494, this painting. The next one. The next one is of the famous Flemish master, Pieter Bruegel de Oude. And if we tell the name, if we mention the name Pieter Bruegel de Oude, we always think about pancakes, but he's more than that. Because, yes, that is true. If everybody think about Pieter Bruegel, oh, he's not so big artist, because he's making all those farmers, the parties of the farmers, etc. But he's a very, very intellectual man. He's a humanistic man. He's a Renaissance man who was who had contacts in Italy, in Switzerland, etc. He went to Sicily. He liked, he adored Italy as well, and he made a lot of sketches. And he's the most significant artist of Dutch and Flemish Renaissance. A painter, but also printmaker. He had a big workshop in Antwerp, and he was well known of the landscapes and peasant scenes. We call it genre painting. And genre painting is new at that time and will be very famous in the 17th century. With Pieter Bruegel, he made the basis. And he also made beautiful watercolors, so I show you this one. His work was influencing the painters in the 17th century. He traveled, was impressed by the nature. In fact, he would like to make always nature subjects, but at that time it is not suitable because nature, you cannot make a landscape only, because that's not worth. The highest position that time is a mythological scene or a religious scene or historical scene of portraits, but not nature. But he started to make attention to nature as well as in watercolors, and that will influence the people after in the 17th century. The next one, I don't know this artist, but I found him and I think, oh, this is interesting. He was born in Antwerp as well, but he lived in Austria. He was a Flemish painter, a printmaker as well, a miniaturist as well, and a draftsman and a merchant. He's noted for his illustrations of natural history subjects, topographical views, illuminations, and mythological works. And he was one of the last manuscript illuminators and had made a major contribution to the development of topographical drawing. His manuscript illuminations and ornamental designs played an important role in the emergence of floral still life painting as an independent genre in Northern Europe at the end of the 16th century. The almost scientific naturalism of his botanical and animal drawings served as a model for a later generation of Netherlandish artists. Through these nature studies, he also contributed to the development of natural history, and he was thus a founder of proto-scientific inquiry. And as we see this watercolor, watercolor needs concentration, but I was surprised to see the man before the opening. He made a beautiful landscape as well in 45 minutes. But it needs, you cannot correct this, correct it, but you see the details. The details, he made it really naturalistic. Yeah, it is, you make a good observation, as we see as well at your exposition. I see, like pictures, like photos. And so a lot of details he made as well. The next one. It's a woman artist, Gesina Terborg, and she was living in Deventer and Zwolle in the 17th century, the Dutch Golden Age, as we call it. She was a watercolorist and drafts movement. And she was born in a family about art. Brothers, they work in the arts, and she wrote as well poetry. And that is what she did. She made books with poetry and then illustrations. That is very interesting because she's a woman. That time, women are not busy with art. So you keep on, you take your subjects. She learned the technique from her father and brothers. As a woman, you choose the domestic things. That is more useful, or flowers like that. And she made a book, Materiebook, between 1652 and 66. And she produced a second album with 116 sheets as well, with songs, poems, and illustration. And all is made by watercolors. The next one, we will see it, like this one. It's a watercolor made by her. And also the next one.
It still happens nowadays. Yeah. Nothing has been changed.
Reflection of real life.
The next one. Goethe is a man who knows everything. He's a political man, but also philosophical. Man, he was he wrote books and he was a scientist, a statesman, theater director. He was an art critic as well. He made poems, but he also paints. He was adoring Italy. He traveled to Italy, and we have to think about the period he was living. He was living about the end of the 18th century. And it's a very important age, because that age we call the Verlichting, the lightness, the base of democratic things. And then up to the 19th century, we call this period the Romantic period. And in the Romantic period, people are looking for the sublime, and the sublime, which is religious, but in a mystical way. In another way than believing in God, for instance, because the universal is very important, and Goethe played a big role in that. He made also watercolors. He went to the Italian island, especially Sicily, and that was of great significance in his aesthetic and philosophical development. His father made a similar journey, so that is why he did it as well. And also because he was studying about the Greek and the Italians. That time there were a lot of discussions. Where is the art coming from the Italian period, or the Roman, or is it the Greek period? What is the most important? What is the most important for our way of thinking or our way of doing? Goethe, he was adoring Winckelmann, we call it Winckelmann, Joachim Winckelmann. he provoked a general renewed interest in the classical art of ancient Greece and Rome, but Winkelmann chose for Greek. So Goethe, he likes especially the nature of Italy, and that is why he made a lot of watercolors in that country as well. In the 19th century, the watercolor became very popular. We can tell the 19th century is the age of the watercolors. It's a flowering time for that time, the watercolor, a richness with subjects, style and technique. A lot of impressionistic and atmospheric landscapes are made, for example. And the two big painters in the 19th century made a lot of watercolors, are Turner and Constable in England. The next one, it's the watercolor of Constable. It's a big competition between those two painters. Constable, he was a very modest man, and Turner, but he was a big man, he showed himself big, and he had a big mouth as well. Constable was more shy and modest. That is nice to see how Constable dealt with it, because Turner, he got all the attention that time. Constable made a lot of works, watercolors as well. But he was not so with marketing. He was not busy with marketing. He said, I should paint my own places best. So he didn't want to travel. And he was working in England, in the south of England, in the neighborhood of Salisbury. You can see there also the church, which he visited a lot of time and painted it a lot of time. He was never financially successful, but the result of his work is so, so beautiful, the freshness of light and color. He was interesting in the in weather circumstances. So every morning he was walking, looking at above what is going on with the clouds, and he makes studies in watercolors at that time. In his lifetime, Constable sold only 20 paintings in England, but in France he sold more than 20 in just a few years. Despite this, he refused all invitation to travel internationally to promote his work. He said, I would rather be a poor man in England than a rich man abroad. So he loved his country. Constable quietly rebelled against the elite, against the artistic culture, like Turner is busy to do. When I sit down to make a sketch from nature, the first thing I try to do is to forget that I have even seen a picture. He's involved with the picture. He was interesting. In the next one, we see more clouds as well. You see how it's smoothing as well, how the colors is going on into another. And he said, I think the watercolor is very suitable for depicting clouds because of the soft transitions. The next one will show William Turner, a big master as well. I joke that he's a big man with a big mouth, but he made nice pictures, that we have to say. Constable and Turner, the big boys of that time, the romantic time as well, like Goethe. Turner traveled, Constable didn't. He only stayed around Salisbury. Turner, he made 2,000 watercolors and 30,000 works on paper. That is also a distinctive style of painting. He used watercolor technique with oil paints. He made a combination with the paintings. We see the lightness, the fluency, and the atmospheric effects, what we see in his works. He liked Italy as well, so he went to Venice. He made the Canal Grande and the San Giorgio Maggiore. The next one, the San Giorgio Maggiore, yes, that is Venice as well. And the next one, beautiful watercolors as well, what we see. Yeah, And the next one, that is another one. That is a woman as well in Belgium, 19th century. She made this. But I couldn't find a lot about this woman, because a lot of Louise d'Orléans in Belgium and France and in Italy. So nothing about paintings, but anyway, I like to show this because what I said, the 19th century is the century of the watercolorist. And the next one is Turner as well, Venice as well, the Cameralde. Yeah, the next one shows a very, very, very nice painting.
Wow.
John Singer Sargent. I like John Singer Sargent as well, with his oil paintings, but also the watercolors. And the watercolors brought out a different side to Sargent's work. His oil paintings has muted colors, dark and imposing backgrounds, and finely rendered subjects. But on the other hand, his watercolors are generally much more relaxed, with loose brushwork and an impressionist feel. His watercolor work probably felt like a refreshing break. He ended up creating over 2,000 watercolors as well. And 2,000 watercolors. The colors weave into each other, creating the illusion of movement. The boats, by contrast, for instance, were painted with more rigid and broken brushwork. Sargent used fairly accurate values, colors, and shapes. He painted many watercolors of Venice as well. And for the buildings, notice how they are basically just large color shapes with dark, simple accents of the top. And so he has a fluently way of working. Look at the water. The brush is very easy. Very easy. The next one is total different, with a big master as well. Dutch man, Anna Tadema, now it's Anna Tadema. He went to London, he's British as well. Classical, he was inspired by the Roman and the Greek periods. He went to Italy as well, to Rome. And though admired during his lifetime for his draftsmanship and depiction of classical antiquity, he was successful, visiting Italy. Details in his work, he has a good observation. Details is very, very important. Very fine. The result is very fine. Also, the pottery, which you will see in the next one, not the pottery, but the marble in this way, especially the marble. You couldn't, this is a watercolor, and marble is like real marble. It is, he was called as well, the marble painting, the marble painter. He's a very brilliant watercolorist. He was a perfectionist as well. He was sensitive to every detail and architectural line of his paintings, as well the settings, the compositions as well. And so this is a different watercolor, for instance, a different way of doing than a Sargent, say a Sargent, for instance, that is more looser, fluently. The next one, also a Dutch painter, Jan Toorop. Late work, Jan Toorop, because Jan Toorop, he was an impressionist in the 80s of the 19th century, a social realist, and he was a very big artist, and he made also impressionistic work, Art Nouveau as well, Lichtenstiel, and different kind of styles, but at the end of his life also he made this kind of work. He was visiting Domburg, a place in Zeeland and Holland, a lot of times because of the light, and that is why he experimented as well with a lot of techniques. The next one. Yeah, as I told, the 19th century is the age of the watercolors. In a lot of countries you see societies. So this is in France. This is the Société d'Aquarelliste Français. And it was an association of painters in watercolor. It was, it was that time, 1819, there was an exposition. But it was the first time, it was years before. It had an annual exhibition of works by members, And the first was held by Durand Ruel. And Durand Ruel was art dealer, and he did a lot for the impressionistic people as well, also for Van Gogh, for instance, that time Van Gogh lived in Paris, in Paris. So he was active since that time to make every year an exposition. But also in Belgium. The next one. Oh, sorry, yes, I have to. The Société Royale Belgique des Aquarellistes was founded in 1856 in Brussel with Jean-Baptiste Madou. And in Holland as well, we have the Hollandse Tekenmaatschappij in Den Haag, 1876, which was an international society with the aim to make the aquarelle, the watercolor, on a higher level. In fact, Constable and Turner made the watercolor on a higher position. So that is why at the beginning of the 19th century, other countries are following, other artists are following. But Constable and Turner is a very big remarking point in the history of watercolors. Also in England, the Royal Watercolor Society was existing as well since the 19th century. Van Gogh, he made a lot of drawings and also watercolors. He made it very quick. He was quick. He made a lot of work. He was obsessive to work in different kind of techniques. And this is what we see as well as a result of Van Gogh. And the next one is Van Gogh as well, with bright colors. And the bright colors. That time he was in Paris. He went to Paris from Brabant, from the south of Holland, which is more brown. But when the time he came in Paris, 1888, he was influenced by the Impressionists, and then he was using colors. So this is also one. A man who was important to stimulate other painters to make watercolors, that is Mesmer, next one. He stimulated the colleagues of the Haagse school. We have a group of painters at the end of the 19th century. We call the Haagse school. And they went to Scheveningen, they went to Katwijk, to the fishers' villages, the seaside, etc. And they make the paintings there. And Mesdag was a big man to stimulate all his colleagues there. He was in Barbizon. Barbizon is the village in the south of Paris, outside Paris, in Fontainebleau, in the woods of Fontainebleau, where people are starting with realistic farmers, pictures, etc. The other one is also from Mesdag. This one. He likes ships. And then the next one is Jozef Israels, also one of the Haagse school. He showed the people, the fishermen, in their families, realistic things. The next one is from Sweden.
Oh, okay, so.
And he had the roller clip woman as well. This kind of, also watercolor. She's famous by her cats. She always paints cats. And then the next one is Andersson. I like Andersson as well, a Swedish artist. And he was able to depict the individual character of the models. But he liked the details as well, the liveliness, the bright colors. He made many travels, also to France, Italy. And the result is often brilliant and luminous in his watercolors. And the numerous members of the high society are his models. He used warm and sometimes warm and cool light and shade areas with contrasting areas of warm and cool ones. So reflecting things. It's very nice to see the light, how the light is working on the subject of the painting. The next one. This is the first watercolor. This is the first watercolor in abstract art. The first one, Kandinsky. Kandinsky was a Russian painter. He was studied law and mathematics in Petersburg, but he went to München. München was a big city at the beginning of the 20th century, modern art city, Art Nouveau city, Jugendstil city. And he started there a group, the Blauwe Reiter, and he was experienced with music as well. He was friends with Schoenberg. Schoenberg started to paint, and Kandinsky was influenced by the music of Schoenberg. So you see as well the first abstract watercolor. He's showing from his inner side, from his inner character, to do this in an impulsive way. That is what Kandinsky is doing. And he thinks about music as well. And most of the pictures don't have titles at that time. He called it composition 1, composition 3, or composition 4. And then the last one is from a Belgian artist, Leon Spiljaert. He was living in the environment of Ghent, the Leijenstreek. And he was part of a group of the painters there as well. And he, what we see here is a watercolor with straight lines, but also dreamlike space. And that is what we see in his work, rather a sense of melancholy and silence. I hope you enjoy to see from the beginning of the human being on the rocks, the watercolor on the rocks, the Roman time, the murals, and then going on all the centuries. Watercolors were always there, but since the 19th century, there is more attention to it, and they want to put it on a high level, like oil paintings, like that. That is most important aim of the societies which was growing in the 19th century in different countries. That was the aim, to have them on a high level. I hope you enjoy it, to have an impression about it, and then also put congratulations again with your nice expositions. And it's
Thank you so much, Lisette. I think that with much ease you could talk 1 hour more about all these interesting things. And personally, I think maybe you will come again at our club, because there's a lot of interesting things to tell about. It's a very amazing history, but you rarely hear anything about it. So thank you so much.